LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
Adam Carolla, Dr. Drew.
I'm not modeling anymore for the two of you.
LoveLine. LoveLine.
It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician. Tonight, our guest from VIP, Molly Culver, is in our studio. She plays Tasha Dexter, not Gertrude Wittenberg, which is the names of most the heroines on television these days.
And wouldn't most sort of male heroes be Dexter, Tasha, something like that?
Yeah, it might work. They don't have a lot of good Jewish names on TV. Molly is... I'm guessing probably did the drdrew.com at some point.
She did. She did the webcast.
That was fun. That was a lot of fun.
And she's just absolutely beautiful. I know she has a crush on me.
That's all we talked about for the entire show.
Yeah. We didn't even get to any of the real problems.
She kept talking about how disappointed she was that you didn't come to watch her.
What?
She doesn't believe I use this cup every night.
Yeah, you know what? I really think they just brought that out. That's okay.
Absolutely
not.
It's
nice to see it. It's just nice to see
There's no way anyone here has that kind of forethought. No possible
it's a
way.
VIP cup.
Yes. I mean, it would take some planning, some lucidity, some something. This show does not contain any of that. I guarantee you that Drew has been using that cup since it was dropped off here 6 months ago. Is that right, Drew?
Who dropped it off? I can't remember that.
What's her name? The sassy brunette.
Oh, yeah.
Natalie did. Natalie bring you a mug?
Yeah, she sure did.
Natalie brought
her people did.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I'll have to send you something.
My mug is at home, but I get great use out of it. Hey, black coffee mugs are the way to go, especially oversized ones. Molly is, she's a delight. And I think it's safe to say that Drew has a sensible crush on her as well. You like Molly,
yeah,
right?
Sensible, yeah.
Yeah. Molly, we know, has done her fair share of modeling. I remember your dad was a jet pilot,
exactly.
Fighter pilot.
Yep.
Mom is half Chickawa and Tamakakasukawa.
Grandmother? My grandmother was half Choctaw Indian.
Yeah. Do you...
Chickasaw. But you're close. You had a combination in there.
She into the fire water? There's not an Indian alive who doesn't drink. I mean, she had to drink pretty good, still, right? Right, but that's what killed her, right?
Actually, you're right.
Yeah.
Well, she was a diabetic, and she died in the 70s.
Right. Well, they didn't have insulin back then. Is that what you need for diabetes? All right, here's my point. You don't have the problem with the booze, do you?
No.
Yeah, it's too bad. That was my only shot out the window. Now, Molly has one of these boyfriends that's just big and tall and good-looking and crushes your hand when he shakes
him.
It. And he's like some kind of a doctor windsurfer model.
No,
pro.
Actually,
oh, you got rid of him. Oh,
gone.
My God.
Uh-huh.
Thank God.
He's
that's gone. That dead weight. Thank God you cut him loose. He was a problem. I'd had it up to here with him. I knew you could do better. That's how I was going to end
thank
that.
You.
Good. Are you single now?
Yes.
Oh, all right. Finally. It's all falling into place now, Drew.
You're lit up.
Jesus Christ. I should have worn something, huh? At least not what I wore yesterday.
That's not what you wore yesterday.
Oh, that's right. That's what I was going to wear yesterday, but then I got a shirt at the last moment. All right. I'm going to go to the bathroom and clean myself up. I don't have any sauce on me or anything, do I?
What do you mean by sauce?
I just want Nate. I don't mean hollandaise. I mean like spaghetti sauce.
No.
I just want Nate.
Like wine or something. Booze.
All right. Single
you look
now.
Nice. You look comfortable.
Yeah, thank you. That's quite a compliment.
Comfortable.
When did you guys break up? It's been a little while?
It's actually been since, not that long ago. Not that long ago.
Are you hurting?
I might
looking
be
to rebound?
A tiny bit. No, I'm not into rebound.
Bet you could use a good back rub. Well, I know how it is. A lot of tension in your business. No
I'm
one
on
to come
hiatus.
Home to?
I'm on hiatus.
Oh, all right. Well, forget the rub. But a hot tub always feels good, especially when it's nice out, right?
Couldn't hurt. Couldn't hurt on some days.
All right. So what happened? You dumped him, though, right?
You know what? We tried to do a long-distance thing from New York to L.A. It just didn't work.
Never going to work. He'll never do better than you, ever. I'd like to talk to him about that. You won't even do the same. That's what I would tell him. You're not even gonna come close.
And then you laugh maniacally.
And I hold my belly. Foolish mortal. Yeah. And then VIP, I know I get more and more condescending whenever I talk about it, but who knew it would be this kind of hit?
Well, you know what? To be perfectly honest, the show sold 2 years in a row. Like, sold 2 years before we ever ever shot one episode. So it had a better chance out of the gate than a lot of shows.
Which is interesting, because so many shows on television do not have a chance to develop.
Not even. But, well,
right.
You know,
like our shows.
There's the star power of Pamela Anderson. Yeah. You know, she's a big deal, and she's big. Her following's massive in Europe, and we're already in, like, you know, 40 countries all over everywhere.
You know what's weird about those Europeans? On one hand, we look at them as some sort of cultural template for us, you know? And if there's a hair product or a hand cream, as long as it came out of somewhere in Europe, yes, fishermen's in Sweden use it, or women, Nordic women have been using this for years. It's a big deal, but yet they're into Hasselhoff, Pam Anderson, Jerry Lewis. They're really a little bit screwed up when it comes to the celebrities. They seem to have the cars and the hand cream worked out. A little bit twisted with the celebrities.
Yeah,
I mean, nothing wrong with Pam Anderson, but, you know, if you got to follow someone, why her and Jerry Lewis and Hasselhoff?
I think if you were eating, like, fine foods every day, you'd really go for the, like, disgusting hot dog.
You'd want a chili dog. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, I think Pam and Jerry and Hasselhoff are the sort of American chili dogs we're sending over there.
If you were like, in just taking in, you know, wonderful art and culture all day long.
That's interesting.
You'd go spin out the other way once in a while.
That's a very interesting point. Yeah, they got it too good over there, and they want to punish themselves with Hasselhoff. Very interesting. To me, it's a total random sort of spin of the cosmic wheel, what American celebrity they decide to embrace over there. But, you know, if you got to go with one, you might as well go with Pam Anderson.
Don't you think Pam represents the American dream of woman? I mean, if you're a European and you're thinking about
she's
beautiful. You know,
she represents what they think we think women are supposed to be.
Yeah, I think you're right.
That's what that is.
Yeah.
She's very, very American. She's like taking three American women, putting them in a Cuisinart, pouring them into culottes, and sending her over there.
But my opinion is that Pam's, I'm sort of a female. I call
female impersonator. That's what Drew. Drew doesn't make too many astute observations, contrary to popular belief. But that was one of them. He said Pam Anderson was a female impersonator, and I thought, yep, you are dead on that
one. You know what I'm saying? She's fetishized her entire self. She happens to be female, and she happens to have chosen a female fetish.
Yep.
And she's just taking all that on.
Hey, but listen, if you gotta be a female impersonator, and listen to me, all you idiots out there that are tucking your penis between your legs, be a female.
Start as a female.
Yeah, you males should work on being male impersonators. And maybe Hasselhoff is a male impersonator.
Maybe you're a male impersonator. Maybe it's all this man show bravado and stuff is about.
Interesting.
God. I'd be better looking, though.
Yeah, that's Jimmy.
More
you're
time.
Right. It's Jimmy.
Yeah, he's the heartthrob of the show. Yeah, I'd put more time into my appearance, wouldn't I? I think I'd, you know, go to the tan salon, go to the gym, pluck a few things. You know what I'm saying?
That's not a male. You'd even be grosser.
Yeah, but if I was a male impersonator, I'd be on steroids. That's the argument I'm making.
Yeah,
all right.
You know,
well, anyway.
Right. I think you're right.
VIP, everyone, check your local listings because it varies from city, state
all
to state.
All weekend long, though,
but
summer.
You certainly can find it all weekend, and lots of fun cameos. Rick?
Yeah, hi.
You're 16. What's up?
I have two questions, and I also have a suggestion for the man show.
Which I saw, by the way. I saw the man show.
Oh, boy.
It's what?
Yeah, what do you want? What is it?
You're impressed, weren't you?
I saw? I saw space women dangling eating big bananas.
You saw the Millennium Show. That was a tough one to see. You watch tomorrow night. You'll see a better one. Rick,
uh-huh.
All right, give me your lame suggestion so I can not use it in the show, and then we'll get to your question.
Okay, well, I was thinking maybe you guys could do a Rambo takeoff where Jimmy Kimmel got kidnapped by the Church of Scientology and you jumped through a skylight to save him.
Interesting.
They were trying to brainwash him.
Not in the budget, but we did have a long Scientology discussion today with at a writer's meeting.
How bizarre is that, though?
It is a little bizarre in how I was going to get into the Church of Scientology.
And that has never come up in the Man Show.
No, not in any meeting. And 4 hours ago, I was sitting around with a bunch of writers talking about Scientology.
That's exactly when I thought of that.
All right. Kismet.
All right, something's wrong.
So what's up there?
Thoughts have existence.
Rick, I'm already over it, though. What is your problem?
Well, I know you're going to think this is bogus, but I have a friend, and I've known her for years, and we've been really close. And also, you know, I have a girlfriend that I really love, and my friend is after me, and she has been for, like, the last few months. And I don't want to have sex with her, but she keeps on and on and on. And I've told her no. And I've told her, you know.
She went nothing but the straight. She is your friend?
Yeah.
And what's the nature of this friendship?
I mean, best friends. I mean, I only have, like, three really close friends.
Does she have sort of a tough history where boundaries are things that are difficult for her to maintain?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's been in her relationship. She's had really hard times.
But what? This is just your friend, right?
Yeah.
Well, how about his boundaries about keeping her at bay? I mean, but speaking of boundaries, we can't even guess what she is, but if he's letting her in, he's not clearly declaring boundaries.
I am. I have. Right. She just won't quit.
You don't want to have sex with her?
No.
What's wrong with her? She's unattractive, right?
No, I love my girlfriend, and if I did, it would destroy our relationship.
All right, but listen, Rick, you got to lay the law down then.
I think Molly's being right. She's picking up on the fact that you are not being clear, at least, or clear enough for this person to hear exactly where you're at.
Yeah.
And you're probably afraid you're going to hurt her feelings, and probably you will. But that's what has to happen before she actually hears you.
Jason.
Yeah.
You're 19. What's up?
Hey, how's it going, Adam?
Good.
How you doing, Drew?
Jason.
I was about 5 or 6, and me and my cousin were outside of my grandma's house. And over Cerritos, I guess, we heard a big boom, and we looked up, and two Cessna private-owned planes collided together. Yeah. And we saw it, like, coming to the ground.
Right.
And go figure, my dad takes us down there to go see, and there's body parts and everything laying on the floor and on the houses and stuff.
Wait, was this the flight from Mexico that ran into a Cessna over Cerritos?
Yeah.
Oh, it was?
A jet and a Cessna.
Yeah.
When was this? About 15 years ago?
Yeah. About 12, yeah.
Really? I don't remember that.
Oh, yeah.
How many people died?
Oh, a couple hundred. It was a flight from Mexico that ran into a Cessna.
Oh, so, hey, Jason?
Yeah.
You need help telling your stories. It wasn't a couple of Cessnas.
Well, he was young, and maybe he didn't really understand what he was saying.
Well, listen, you can figure it out in the next 13 years. Yeah. I mean, one's a commercial passenger jet.
Yeah.
That's a difference between 150 people rather than the two Cessnas hitting.
From that point on, I've been, like, terrified of flying.
All right.
Understandably.
Since we witnessed it, and my dad took us down there.
I understand. That makes sense.
And I was wondering, Drew, if you had any advice or...
Well, where are you going?
A number?
Well, Jason, people develop what's called a post-traumatic stress reaction to things like this. It's like some circuitry opens up in your brain as a result of overstimulating circumstances that make difficult to sort of screen these things out after these arousals have sort of etched their sort of mark into you.
You got to get good and loaded. Let me explain something. And yes, you go to hypnotherapist. Yes, you could do biofeedback training. You could read books. You could work with a counselor. You can break off into some discussion group. Or you could get loaded and take care of it that day.
Well, there is.
You really could. You get some of those pills Drew got me, and you wash it down with a couple Bloody Marys before while the plane's taxing.
You can go to any VA hospital and find lots of guys that have tried to deal with PTSD that way.
Well, here's the deal, though. These guys, these Vietnam vets, these World War II vets, or whatever, these guys are shell-shocked. They're having this experience every day. Jason,
just from relation to flying,
he's getting on a plane once every 4 years to go see his relatives in Iowa. He's got to pull it together one day out of the year.
There is something to what you're saying, is that you can medicate
somebody
to be able to fly. And what people learn is if they're able to tolerate flying without having the anxiety reaction, the sort of uncouples the experience from the reaction, and they I had awful fear of flying for a long time.
You make it a few hundred thousand miles with the booze in you, and eventually you wean yourself off.
Now we're flying on one-engine planes with somebody reading the Roberto Clemente story in front of us.
It's true. And no one knows what you're talking about with that. Roberto Clemente died in a plane crash, and even Drew didn't even know what was going on until I pointed it out to him.
Well, I knew about Roberto Clemente. I didn't realize what the story
was. You weren't looking at the USA Today that I was looking at with Roberto, poor departed Roberto, on the cover while the smoke was coming out of the engine.
So did you just get back on the plane? Is that what it is? You just started flying and you felt better? How did you deal with your fear of flying?
Let me explain how Drew overcame that. Drew is scared of flying, but his biggest fear is not making a buck. So here's how you cure that. You give him 10 grand to fly across the country, and that is overridden by his fear of flying. His love of money is squelched by his fear of flying. And his penny-pinchingness is overridden by that. Wouldn't you say that's a fair estimation, Drew?
The cheapness I'll take on. That one I'll take.
Right. And it didn't sound like a word. But the point is someone gives you a few bucks, you'll do anything.
No.
Oh, come on. You do gay porn. If I went to the ATM right now and came back with a video camera, I'd shoot a gay porn with you.
That's what I want to do. But that's
secretly, yeah.
I had to have several experiences flying where it just didn't occur to me to get anxious. I did it enough.
You do it enough.
How about that first time?
Oh, it was awful. Awful.
I was the same way, though, like white-knuckled and stuff. And then we started doing it.
You're afraid to fly?
I was the same way as Drew, which was I never flew. I never got on a plane really until I was like 30, because I grew up in North Hollywood and I didn't know what the airport was.
You didn't go until you were 30. You didn't get on a plane until you were 30.
I called them magic birds. I didn't even know there were people in them. I just stare at them from the ground. Yeah. No. Well, I grew up in North Hollywood. I was poor, you know, and then I went to work doing construction, and I didn't have any family that
Makita
was out of the state. I'm not wearing my Makita hat, though, am I? The point is I didn't know anyone in New York. I never had enough money to go to Hawaii. I never had any money. I couldn't do anything, and until I started my second career.
So how did you get a fear of flying if you just didn't fly? Is it just...
Well, part of it is it's like if you pulled some Cro-Magnon man out of a cave and told him that he was going to be flying 33,000 feet above the ground, he'd freak out. Yeah. And that's how I was. My reptilian brain couldn't cope with the idea that I'd be going 500-600 miles an hour and not dying.
Yes.
So it wasn't something that I was used to. And it was like kind of white-knuckly at the beginning. But after doing it tons and tons of times, you just stop thinking about it. It's like anything else. Yeah. And plus, I'm loaded.
That's where you keep with that idea of getting loaded, and that's why you do that every time.
Right, and the good thing about me is I've carried it over to my ground life, too. Now I get on a plane twice a year, but I'm loaded the rest of the days while I'm on the ground. You know what I don't like about flying when you're drinking? I don't like it when they wrestle the drink away from you when they're taking off.
Yeah.
They always want that drink back, and it's always a good 45 minutes before you get in the air. Like, the plane is just starting to back out of the stall, and they're like, diving. We're going to need that. And I'm like, hold on. And I'm shotgunning the Bloody Mary, and she's reaching for the glass, and I'm sucking on the ice cubes. And she's like, give it back. No, hold on. One more sip. And then they take it, and then you roll back 10 feet, and you stop, and you sit there for an hour and 45 minutes. By the time you get out to the tarmac and actually start doing anything, it's been a full half hour since she dove on you and wrestled the Bloody Mary out of your hand. I don't understand that. True? Why should I fly first class if I'm going to be wrestled that way for my cocktails?
Because you can get loaded like you do every time.
That's right.
Even when you're wrestling.
D, you're 35.
Right.
What's up?
I've been married for 19 years now, I have no sex drive, and it's been going on for a long time.
19 years, that means you got married when you were 14?
Matter of fact, 16. I've been married twice. When I was 14, I got pregnant.
Oh.
And when I was 15, I got pregnant. So I finally married my first husband, and I was with him for 5 years. And then I was probably divorced maybe 2 months, and I married the man I'm with now.
So, how's that going?
And I had two more kids with him, so I got four kids altogether, but they're all grown just about, and but I have no sex drive, and it's been going on for a long time now.
So you're associating this lack of sex, of libido, with...
I could care less if I get it or not.
I understand. You're associating that with the duration of your sort of sexual life? The fact that it started so young?
Maybe.
Your vagina's worn out?
Well, let's consider some alternatives. You smoke cigarettes?
Yes.
A lot?
Yes.
And that can affect your sex drive.
Okay.
You drink alcohol?
No.
Oh, come on.
You did.
No, I swear
you,
I don't.
You did. Quit last weekend.
When did you stop?
And I do smoke marijuana.
Marijuana.
Uh-huh.
Marijuana's
but I do not drink. I swear I don't.
All right. We knew we were using something, and marijuana will absolutely shut down your libido and make you terribly depressed.
Oh, see, I went to the doctor, and they diagnosed me as an antidepressant.
Well, you didn't tell him about your pot habit, did you?
Yes, I did.
Was it a psychiatrist?
He didn't say anything about it.
Was it a psychiatrist?
Well, he was cool.
Well, no, wasn't, so I can't afford to go to one of them.
Well, that's what you need.
Because I do have a lot of major problems.
What are your major problems?
Oh, God, I'd be on the phone forever, man.
Okay.
I do have some major problems.
Oh, boy.
I think that might be...
Can you get antidepressants from my doctor?
I can't hear you.
Where are your kids?
Well, I have my oldest one is 21. He lives on his own. Well, he has roommates, and he's been gone almost a year now, but I see him, you know, every now and then.
Fantastic.
I have a 20-year-old that's still here, still lives with us.
Yeah.
And then I have a 16-year-old, and I have one daughter. That's my youngest, and she's 14.
Oh, boy.
She's getting ready to...
Yeah.
Right.
Is she pregnant yet?
Oh, God, no. She knows what it's like to, for my experiences.
Yeah.
That
doesn't always prevent it. All right, well, what else is wrong with you besides that?
What are your big problems
in the weed?
Well, I'm not happy with my looks, myself. I don't have I have goals. I want to do things, but I just lay around.
That's pot, my dear.
I
swear to God, that's pot. And I don't know why we can't have a discussion about what this drug does to people when they use it regularly all the time. The most important thing is you get depressed, and that needs to be treated. An antidepressant will not correct it. If you try stopping by yourself, the depression will become profound. You need to go to MA. If you can't afford to see a psychiatrist who's familiar with dealing with marijuana dependency, which is a profound dependency for some people, you got to go to MA. You got to go.
All right. Listen, we don't talk about it too much, but pot is not inherently evil, but too much of anything is going to screw you up, and there are plenty of people that smoke way too much pot and have no idea the effect it is having on them. I can tell, we know when we talk to them three syllables into the conversation if they smoke on a regular basis. I smoke pot whenever I get a chance, but that isn't that often. And people do this, and it's part of it is the people's fault, part of it's the government's fault for this whole lousy smear campaign they try to run with all this reefer madness and everything. And, you know, it's like the government would never discern between somebody who smoked one joint a year and a hay bale a night. You're either on the weed or you're not. You're either breaking the law or you're not. You're either abusing or you're not. And that's ridiculous. Everybody I know smokes pot on occasion, but they're responsible, successful people. And just like any other successful person, or just like booze or gambling or whatever, there's a time and a place for it. And it's not when you wake up in the morning on a Tuesday before you head into your job. And I just wish the government would approach it that way, and I wish the people would approach it that way, because people who smoke a ton of weed are in denial. You
How
smoke
would they
a lot.
Would they just legalize it then and then let people deal with it responsibly, or no, just do it illegal?
I think that both camps
I think they
are,
should,
are,
yeah.
Yeah, I kind of do too, I got to tell you. But I think both camps are equally as irresponsible.
Right, but
making it's nothing or it's
well,
deadly.
How do you rectify that? How do you
get the political
you let
energy?
I'm in charge. That's how you do it. You do what makes sense. Woody Harrelson says it's good for you, and whoever the hell the Bennett or whoever the drug czar is this week tells you, anyone who possesses a roach should have their house repossessed, and it's ridiculous. The point is in the hands of responsible people, it's no worse than anything else. The problem is people overdo it. It affects their lives, and they don't know it. And I'd like the government to say, hey, it ain't going to kill you, but it will screw you up slowly over the course of time. All right. I got to get high. Drew?
I was just thinking, it took us 60 years. Well, it took us 200 years to get around to nicotine. tobacco.
Right.
So we're going to have a honest discussion about what that drug does. So.
Well, now it's gone the other way.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's I see commercials about 400,000 Americans a year dying from nicotine. One-third of the people who smoke cigarettes are killed by it. They can't substantiate any of that. And what about all the secondhand? What happened to secondhand smoke? Oh,
remember
it's
that?
Gone.
Yeah, it's killing
what happened
everybody.
To it?
It's killing
yeah.
us all.
I guess it killed everybody, and there's no reason to talk about how secondhand smoke kills or how if I lit up one cigarette in this booth, it would be equivalent to you two smoking a carton of non-filters somehow. You idiots with your, the government, you know, the tobacco industry has their own scientists who put their own spin on it, and then the government has the same or a different group of retarded scientists putting their own spin on this thing too, and they're both way off.
We'll be
please.
Right back.
All right, we'll take a break.
LoveLine. 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 We'll be right back.
This is LoveLine on Outrageous Talk Radio 100.7 The Buzz. This is LoveLine on Outrageous Talk Radio 100.7 The Buzz.
LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Molly Culver's our guest tonight. She plays Tasha Dexter. She's the smart one and the good-looking one from VIP, which is on. It's on different times, but it's always Saturday night.
Fox.
And they seem to repeat it on Sunday. Is at least out here in L.A. I remember seeing the premiere when we were in Syracuse, Drew.
That's right.
Staying at
the Hilton, the Sheraton across the street.
Staying at some hotel. I got back to my room. I watched a show, and I said, this will never, ever last. And I've never been more wrong.
That's when
about
it was taking itself seriously.
Yeah.
You
now,
think?
Yeah.
Now, I think we did try at the beginning to actually
I know. I know. Everyone puts a spin on it, and it's smart, too. But it was... I think the show originally did not have its tongue planted so firmly in its cheek. And then somebody realized, it seemed like a couple months in, hey, let's just put our tongues in our cheeks and have a good time.
It got progressively campy, it's for sure. We were a real bodyguard agency. The fun part about it was taking it seriously, and it was a joke because we took it seriously. And then it just progressed into a joke.
who's on it? Who are some good cameos coming up?
We had Lee Majors. I don't know if that's run yet.
He's asking. See.
Ah. Well, you guys should come down and guest star on the show.
Yeah.
You guys should come down and be on the show. You want to?
Yeah.
I think we can work that out.
Yeah.
She delivered that like she meant it.
Yeah, she did.
I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding.
I'd written a spec script for VIP. It's in the trunk of my car. And maybe tonight,
floating women
over,
bananas,
over
I know,
a cup
I know,
of coffee, we can go over some of the beats. I gave you a big, juicy part. More dialogue than Pam has in this
Thank
episode.
Thank you.
Oh, yes.
Appreciate it.
You're a good talker. That's what I like about you. Linda?
Mm-hmm.
You're 19.
I'm 19.
What's up?
Okay, well, I have this problem where when me and my boyfriend are having sex, mm-hmm. he goes in, like, too much.
And it hurts.
And he hits something.
Hit your cervix.
Is that my cervix?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or the box spring. No.
Okay, well, how do I go around that? How can...
You tell him not to do that. Or...
You use the batting donut. Yeah. As an invention, the love grommet, I think it was called. I haven't talked about this in a while. Not something that I need personally, but I know some of my big penis friends out there could use it. It's a piece of foam rubber with a hole in it. It looks like a donut. It's got about a 1 inch, 1 1/4 circumference hole in the middle of it. The thing overall, the OD of the thing is probably about 2.5-3 inches. It's made of that nice springy foam. It's about an inch thick. Slide it over the penis. That way you don't get the kind of... Now, hear me out, Molly. You don't, again, I don't require one, but there are those out there who do. You do not get the full depth because obviously you run into the donut before you get the full depth there. And you get a little spring back action to really, heat up the lovemaking.
It's made out of...
It's made out of a space-age polymer. No, it's made out like what a boogie board is made out of. You know, it's like a fun, like what a pad on a motorcycle
the key
crossbar.
The keychains for the boats.
Yeah, those things that float.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it's made of. Nice, right?
Interesting.
Put that on, you just bounce right off. It's like banging a trampoline.
Well, there you go.
There you go, Linda. The love grommet.
Okay, well, I have another question.
Oh, okay.
Okay, well, I have a problem where I can't have an orgasm.
Sure.
Either.
Sure. He's got his penis. It's tickling your lower intestine.
Well, not only then, but oral or by myself either.
Oh boy. Yeah, that's limiting.
Well, that's 18, 19. That's very common, right?
Right.
So.
Is it?
I remember when I was 19, I could only have 9 orgasms a day. I mean, that was at, you know, the hands of myself.
But women, there's no sort of language out there to help women establish that connection with the place they need to find in order to function normally sexually. Some women,
that's the bad
some women, it's pow. Yeah, it's no problem. But most women, particularly your age, it's sort of a place, an intuitive place that you have to understand how to manage. And there's not much out there written by women for women about how this works.
Well, and maybe even at 18 and 19, you're not really looking for the books anyway, you know, to find your answers. That
Is there any way of thinking about a place or an emotional experience that can help her connect with normal function, if she's by herself even?
How about Jerry Lewis or Hasselhoff? Are you from Europe, Linda?
Mm-mm.
No. This is something you're going to have to work on yourself, but I think you're going to have to sort of, you know, shut the lights, light a candle, you know, have a little red wine or whatever you chicks do, and sort of figure yourself out a little.
Well, I can't even, like, do it by myself. I mean, I find no pleasure in masturbation at all.
Yeah, well, that's your job now. That's your life's
what if she
work.
What a vibrator.
Yeah, how about a vibrator?
No, I've never really tried one.
Well, I hate to say, but look into it.
Really?
Yeah.
Give it a shot. Why not?
And then again, the focus on how you feel at ease and comfortable with yourself and or with your boyfriend.
Molly, I'm no woman, but I
really,
I know how they work. I really do. And I
do young men know how women work?
No,
I mean,
no,
it's like
no
he, so. There's like no way
no
a boyfriend
idea.
Even knows.
They know more about space lab than they know about the vagina.
So how can she actually if she's a nervous to find out about herself by herself, she can maybe he's open enough to help her find out about herself
as well.
But he has to
be listening, and she has to feed back to him. And most people don't do that.
Really?
Yeah, not at 18.
All right. Well, let me ask you, Molly. I won't get too personal here, but how old are you now?
I'm 32.
Wow. Really? 32. Yeah, you really look good. What do you do? Not go outside or something? What do you do? Does someone keep you in a closet for 5 years?
So I think it's my native heritage.
Up on a rack or something, and man, it's like someone must have like mothballed you in your 20s or something, and took you off and dusted you off, took you out of the closet and dusted you off or something. Wow. Anyway, you're 32 now. There's a big difference between when you were 18 or 19 and now, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sexually. Am I right, or
no,
stop
definitely.
Me if I'm,
no,
if
no,
I'm wrong?
No, definitely, definitely.
Is that a biological change, an evolution, or is it just a familiarity, a learning?
Learning.
Learning.
Definitely.
Learning.
Definitely.
You haven't changed or developed in some way that
made
things more
accessible.
Doesn't
some of it have to be biology?
No, I really, you know what? I don't think so. I think when you stop and drop the walls and you stop feeling vulnerable in lots of ways where intimacy is not something completely scary and you meet somebody who you're not afraid to explore with or whatever. If that happened at 18, that would have been great. You know, you might have learned more sooner. But if you don't have the opportunity and it's hard.
See, but your libido at 13, 13, at 32 compared to 18... It's stronger now at 32 than it was at 18, right?
You know what? All I really have now that I didn't have then is just confidence, in my ability to do something. That's all.
Right, but how does that translate? Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, it 32, and I'm putting words in your mouth, but I can't help it. I just want you to be horny.
Jesus.
Every woman I've ever spoken to has just been, you know, it's 17, 18, 19, could kind of take it or leave it. I mean, the sex.
There was no libido.
Maybe
was not
wanted
that
a boyfriend, liked guys, may have been boy crazy even, but for the sex, the actual sex part.
Wasn't that big a deal.
Wasn't that into it. And then at 32, 33, 35, wound up like a dreidel, ready to pop.
Maybe a little hair right. of truth now to that, but I'm not going to say 100% because when
you're super horny at 18 is what
that's
you're
not,
saying.
No, it's not about being super horny. It's actually about really wanting an intimacy. Women are different. Women are just different, okay?
Yes.
You're going to, if you want, you know, sex and you're horny at 18, you're horny at 32, women just really, we just want to be held. No,
they come in through love and intimacy.
Yeah.
Sex is about love and intimacy.
I understand that. But
if a man approached you at 18 with love and intimacy, I think that they would want sex just as much as you do at my age right now.
Oh, really?
I just want the love and intimacy.
No difference.
Because when it goes hand in hand, there's a safety zone that you have as a woman.
That young guys cannot deliver that.
No.
No way.
That's the young woman, older man. I mean, an older man can offer someone safe, intimate, you know, environment that makes you feel comfortable enough and relaxed enough to just explore and let your body relax and
enjoy.
And
the men, there is a biological change by that point. They don't want to live anymore.
Right. Ready to die. Yeah. I figure we get one last bit of sex in before we go on the ground. And who do you like more, me or Drew? I mean, you know, you need someone to hold you. We've established that. There can only be one set of hands around you. Who's it going to be? Is it me or Drew? I mean, obviously it's limited to this room. What are you going to do? I know you're a little soft on Drew because he did his internet thing and you're under this false notion that he cares about people and that kind of thing. But what about the more rugged, hairier, outgoing type like myself?
Are you sensitive? You know?
Yeah, I am.
Are you caring?
If I get hit in the nuts, I cry like a baby. Like a baby, right, Drew?
I tell you.
Yeah, I'm sensitive.
Is there a sensitive, intimate man inside this man right here? Is there
You'll
someone
have to
who
find
like
it, though. You'll have to look for it. That'll be your mission, right, Drew? That's good, right?
Mm.
Yeah, it's there. If only the right woman could unlock it.
Where are the cue cards? I don't even see
it. It's going to take the right woman to excavate the sensitive boy that lies within. It may be a little project, but I think you're up to it. Right, Drew?
I don't know if she's able to speak for her.
Okay. All right, well, we'll get into that. We'll figure it out. When we come back, my ass is still sore from my last boyfriend. Oh, please. Anderson, you know, do you see I was making some headway here, and then you got to come with those out-of-context drops. That was completely out of context. I was talking about something else at that time.
My asshole's on fire.
Wow. You got to shut the mics off during the commercials. Yeah, we're going to take ourselves a break. When we come back, we'll speak to Jamie, who's 28, has a very powerful orgasm. Could this be from sexual abuse? Jamie?
Yes.
Oh, Jamie the guy.
Yes, definitely the guy.
Oh, the guy from where?
Jamaica?
Oh, no, take another guess, please.
Hell?
A little further away than that. And it's completely landlocked, so you can scratch out all the islands and stuff.
Really? You come from a place that's completely landlocked?
Yes.
And why do you sound like you sound?
This is how they all sound over there. Zimbabwe?
Huh? Oh, Zimbabwe. Yep. Yeah, there we go.
Uh-huh.
All right, hold on a second.
Splendid.
All right, who molested you?
Several people.
Okay.
Hold on.
All right. Well, maybe a custom or tradition over there. Who we'd argue with their culture. Molly Culver's our guest tonight. We'll take a little break, then we'll get back with Zimbabwe Jamie, figure out who molested him and why he has a powerful orgasm.
We'll be right back with more.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz. This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. He is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Molly Culver's our guest tonight. She's from VIP. Fox, on the weekend, I'm sure, well, it's been, geez, give me the, what date did it air? I mean, premiere, because then I'll tell you when we were in Syracuse walking through
the cemetery. You know, this that movie Snow Day was placed in Syracuse.
No, was,
oh, you were there September.
Cinematic Triumph, by the way.
Who cares?
All right, but the point is, a lot of stuff we saw was...
September 27, 1998.
And it must have been 98, yeah. It's been a couple years now, right? I was looking up the ceiling trying to think.
That's like a bug in the light or something.
Oh, no. All right, so, and still going strong. Now, where the hell were we?
We're talking to a fellow from Zimbabwe.
Zimbabwe, that's right. Jamie.
Hello.
Jamie's 28, has very powerful orgasms.
Yeah, I have one issue, and I have two parts. First of all, I am going into medical school next year, and I've been leaning heavily, and I've been thinking about going into psychiatry.
Okay, great.
Quite a bit.
Good for you.
And now my problem is I've been sexually abused, and I'm going through counseling now, and I plan on continuing. One of the things that really bothers me is I have very powerful and very intense orgasms. And I know I've heard you guys speaking about people being hypersexual or being hyposexual mm-hmm. Once they have been abused.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I want to find out if this is something that I should continue being concerned about or if it's just...
Well, give us an example of your powerful orgasm.
Well, what are you talking about?
Well, I want to know. I mean, I want to know how it manifests itself.
Okay.
I don't mean start playing with yourself. I just mean, what do you do? Do you yell or do you put holes in things? I mean, how does it work?
Well, they feel so intense at times. It's almost, I almost black out.
Yeah. I wish someone molested me. That doesn't sound like a bad deal.
Well, in my case, it's...
All right, so you have, they're very, very, almost spiritual experiences, huh?
It seems that way. I have.
And every time, what about when you masturbate?
When I masturbate as well, it's almost the same, depending.
Really?
Does that mean that does that mean he enjoys them or he doesn't enjoy them? Is that?
Well, I do enjoy them, but I get frightened because it might be an aspect of my personality that
I understand.
Is functional.
Okay.
How old were you when you were sexually abused?
Well, since I was about 5 years old until about 13, 14.
By whom?
Several different people. Five women, two men.
Five women?
Were they?
Hold on a second. I might go for those odds. You know what I mean? Like, you know, five women, two men.
You'd take it.
Yeah, it'd be like, I'd have to think about it for a while, but I'd probably give it. I'd go, yeah, all right. I mean, when do I get the guys? Like Friday and Wednesday? And
depends
then
who the guys
women?
Are. We haven't heard who they are yet.
Yeah.
Could be your dad.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I could handle my dad. He's got the Corolla penis.
Relatives of mine, none of them, my parents or immediate family, like uncle, aunts, and all that sort of stuff.
All right, but how old were you when you first started having orgasms?
You see, I remember being abused when I was at least 6 years old, and I do remember a pseudo-orgasm, so to speak. It was an end point, but...
When did you start having these very intense ones?
Since I was about 20 years old, I felt a gradual increase. I've been married for 4 years. We are divorced, and throughout my marriage, it steadily got more and more and more as my marriage got more and more dysfunctional.
All right. Well, listen, here's our problem.
I'm developing a little theory that there's sort of arousal mechanisms set up in the brain, and then when these kids get traumatized with excessively arousing experiences, that becomes sort of etched into the biology in a way that's sort of not normal.
Mm-hmm.
And that adults then go back to try to, the only way they can access that part of themselves or experience themselves sexually or sort of in a way to try to heal those traumas, perhaps, whatever the motivation is, they go back to that same state of hyperarousal, which is why they make crappy relationships and why they have maybe intense orgasms or need some of the physical abuse during sex.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So wait, so you're saying that he's reliving... Right?
So I'm saying he was sexualized so young and was aroused so profoundly and was, for whatever unique reasons about his biological makeup, was able to be brought to states of arousal that were really not normal for kids.
Right.
he's back into accessing those states of hyperarousal.
Do you think so he's having these huge orgasms, right? And he's feeling, do you think he feels bad also? Do you think it comes back, brings back guilt and brings back those feelings of feeling bad about like having that happen?
A bad part of himself.
A bad part of that's
back? Yeah, a bad part of himself, a bad experience.
You know, it can't be fun for him to even have orgasms, right? But even though they're like almost blackouts and good, he doesn't feel good having them.
Yeah.
Thank God I was never aroused. Now I look back on my non-arousal, and I think, fantastic.
Yes. Their system, their mechanisms of hypoarousal as much as hyperarousal.
Yeah.
And there's some data out there that there's a lot of theories that suggest that your sort of autonomic tone gets set in by these systems and these experiences. And people that are hyperaroused are very, very, very anxious, and the sympathetic tone is high. And people that weren't aroused enough... Adam.
I have an experiment. I think I could masturbate, achieve an orgasm, and keep one of those paddles with the ball going on it. With my bad hand, by the way. I think I could. I think I could not break stride. I'm pretty sure I could do that. I don't know if I could do it when I was with a woman, but I'd like to try that. Molly, what do you say? In the name of science.
No. Sure, for science.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, as long as it's for a good cause. Cindy? I'll get a note from Drew. It'll make it all right. Cindy, you're 17, you goofball. Stop talking to your friends. I was talking to her mom.
I don't want to feel stupid because, you know, they always have stupid.
Oh, boy.
Talking to Dad.
Oh, this ain't going to be a good one for Daddy to hear about.
Cindy?
Hello?
Hello?
Hi.
Who are you talking to?
Talking to my cousin.
Okay. All right. Are you living with your cousin?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's always a bad sign.
Huh?
It's bad when you live with people other than your parents.
Yeah.
And brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
But I have a question.
Yeah.
I had sex with one of my friends like 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
And he ejaculated, like, he cummed and like flew in my eye.
Yep.
And it's infected.
Uh-oh.
And like when I wake up in the morning, it has, you know, like booger. And all that gross stuff in my eye.
Where'd you go to finishing school, Cindy?
It has a booger. The eye has booger.
I understand.
I know what she's talking about.
Yeah.
And, like, I'm, like, sort of embarrassed to go to the doctor.
Sure. Why? Look, just go. Yeah, you got to talk.
Tell
to
him you're running with a cup of semen and you trip.
The problem.
That's what I said.
Fell into a vat.
Yeah.
Problem is, you can get chlamydia and gonorrhea and other infections of the eye.
Well, she has pink eye, right? Do you have pink eye?
Yeah. But it may be chlamydia conjunctivitis.
I know, but it's probably the pink eye.
It's. Well, pink eye is like saying I have pneumonia.
It's like a generic term.
Yeah. Due to what?
Okay, but hold on a second, because we'll get back to you, Cindy. But a lot of people get pink eye, especially when they're younger. I don't know why it is you get
pink eye between
the age of like 10 and 17, and then you never get it again in your life.
You will get it again when you're a parent.
Okay. Also, you can get the pink eye from the...
Why?
Because the kids bring it home.
Oh.
It just gets on your hands, get in your eyes.
Come on, do the math, Molly.
Well, I was thinking... All right. Go ahead.
Okay. And you get the pink eye from the semen in the eye, too, right? Don't you get that from that?
Well,
I've heard about that.
You know, we've talked to people in the past that have...
All right.
Oh, yeah,
all right.
It could be just a chemical irritation, but somebody needs to look at this because the chlamydia pink eye is very dangerous.
Okay.
And the herpes pink eye is more dangerous.
All right. We'll take a break. We'll be back.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191. Oh, wow,
we'll be right back.
This is LoveLine on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
It's LoveLine. We're going to take a quick 10-second timeout, and then we'll be back with more of the program in just 10 seconds.
This is LoveLine on
Radio Station.
Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
KQBZ.
Seattle.
It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla.
I thought there was a hint that we were going to have a lightning round.
Mm.
I said, it's LoveLine.
It's been a couple of days, hasn't it?
And I know how you like to impress Molly.
What's a lightning round?
Yeah.
You can spare her, won't you?
You know what? I've given up on Molly. I really have.
I think she's really... I thought she was warming up.
Starting to warm up a little bit?
Way more than the past...
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Well, my balls look like the chin of an old Chinaman.
Oh, boy.
Well, that's it. Now it's all over. She'll have that echoing in her head for the rest of her life. As you know, Drew, I've always been in love with Molly Culver from the VIP, our guest tonight. For the right reasons. Right, Drew?
What were those?
Come on. You can't do anything? You can't improvise at all?
I think it was her dad. That's what you like.
Flew, magic
though.
Birds.
You don't know what he flew, though, do you?
Yeah, A4s and A7s.
Oh! A4. Oh, well, oh, ooh.
The tank busters, yeah.
No. That's the A10. It's the Warthog. That's the tank buster.
Who's on the carriers?
Yeah, A4 was a great plane. That is the model I'm building. I was telling you that.
Oh, that's right.
That's a jet. Yeah, A4. It's a great plane. Not the F4, but it's very very nice. Yeah, flew off the carrier, so over the Gulf of Tonkin, I'm sure. You have no idea where he flew off. What carrier? Did he fly off carrier?
I don't remember the name of his carrier, but it's been retired.
Oh, okay. Anyway, as you know, Drew, I've always been in love with Molly, right?
We've established
haven't
that.
I?
Yeah, we've established that, yes.
I've always said good things about her, right? In a very respectful way.
Yeah. Reverential.
That's right. Yeah. Even better than respectful. Yeah. I've built a shrine to her out of mayonnaise in my living room.
Oh.
I mean real mayonnaise.
That's my main mayonnaise.
Thank you, Snoop. That's my rap name. You don't know that I'm down with the likes of Snoop. I'm in his posse. Dave. Dave, you're 22. He's asleep.
Asleep. Let's listen. Oh, yeah, you hear him snoring.
All right. Let me see.
Listen. Turn it up there, Anderson. Hear him?
Yeah.
We can hear him. You hear that?
That's awesome.
He's off in the distance.
The guy's asleep.
No greater compliment has ever been paid a talk show host than one-third of his listeners who are on hold for more than 20 minutes fall asleep. And it's not like they're listening to Muzak, by the way. They listen to this show. They fall asleep to the soothing sounds of my voice talking about myself.
Let's hear them one more time.
It's not coming
through. It's too far away, yeah.
See, most of our listeners who fall asleep, the phone jammed up into their mouth. And then there's nothing better. I've never said anything funnier or as funny as one of our listeners snoring into the phone. But he's off it a little bit. Well, let me just check back. Okay, well, he stopped breathing. Is that bad?
Here it is. I guess.
Hair moving around. Dave?
Dave!
You can hear him shuffling around there, can't you?
Sleep apnea.
No, no good.
It's great radio, isn't it? Alicia?
Yeah.
You're 22.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Well, I have sex with anyone who shows interested in me. Whether I'm attracted to them or not, but I have trouble staying interested in one person.
Mm. Yeah. Molly was confiding to me off the air that she had the same problem.
I'm sort of concerned that I might be a nymphomaniac because of that.
How often have you done this, or how often do you do this?
Well, it's just about any time for about the last 3 years.
So and, every weekend, every day, what are we talking about?
Well, probably about every weekend, yeah.
What kind of numbers are you racking up?
Oh, God, I don't even know.
You don't know?
No, I don't.
Aren't you concerned about your health?
I'm very concerned about my health, but at the same time, I'm very safe. I always use a condom and everything, and I masturbate a lot as well. Masturbate at least 2 times a day, so...
That's not a lot. I mean, that's an outrageous number. Right, Molly?
A lot. Well, I'm still having sex every weekend. I mean, it's so much in comparison with all of my friends. It's
so,
just really...
there are basically two scenarios that set women up like this.
You got molested.
Or you're bipolar.
Well, I have definitely never been molested.
Oh, then you're bipolar.
And I have been diagnosed as bipolar, but nobody has ever said anything to me about...
All right, hold on a sec. All right, so we can scratch both those off the list. Goofball. Someone must put a penis in her ear by mistake. All right, you're bipolar, right?
Well, thanks for the diagnosis, Adam.
There you go, goofball.
What am I supposed to do, though? I mean, I'm
let me explain a proper reaction. All right, hold on a second, because our listeners cannot seem to muster this. Go right ahead, Drew.
Well, there's only two.
I got to get it every weekend. Every weekend. There's I put a condom on, I get nailed on it. I'm like a pincushion. I don't know how many times.
The two ways that women come to this point. Uh-huh. One is, Adam says sexual abuse. Drew says, you're bipolar.
That's right. Well, I've never been sexually abused. What's the other one?
Bipolar.
Uh-huh. Well, no. though I am bipolar, yeah. But other than that, your point is completely invalid.
Wait, now let's have the appropriate response.
All right, appropriate response.
You're bipolar?
Yes, I am. And it's interesting you bring that up. What is the connection there? I'm fascinated by this, and
amazing
I'm surprised that during my original diagnosis, this was not brought up. Please tell me more, you sage. Alicia?
Yes.
All right, so now we'll try that again. You're bipolar, right?
Yes.
And now you want to know more, right?
I would like to know how come no one ever told me about this and why...
Hypersexuality is part of being bipolar, but I also suspect... Let me put up my Carnax hat on here for a second. I also suspect they advise you to take medication, then you refuse to do that.
Well, yeah, I did for a while, but I've been on medication for about 3 months now.
All right.
Okay. Well, things should be settling down there. What are you taking?
Hey, Alicia, let me put my Carnac hat on and predict you don't know who the hell Carnac is. Do you know who Carnac is?
No, I don't know who Carnac is.
Oh, man. Drew, you got to hang up your microphone and stethoscope because you're way too old for this demo.
But what we use?
Kreskin.
Kreskin, okay.
I don't even know what it's called. I don't pay attention.
Huh? All right. Hey, you know, our listeners are so goddamn dumb, you can't even make references. I don't know who to... Barney?
Listen.
All right.
So, Alicia, so you didn't take your medicine?
No, I didn't, but I am now.
What
and
are you taking?
I'm still doing it.
What
it's
are you
not
taking?
Getting better.
What are you taking?
I don't know. Do I have to go get the bottle?
Yeah, please.
Wait a minute.
Wait, let's go back to Dave.
How does she not know what medication
because
she's been
she
prescribed?
Is fragmented and manic.
And a little angry. Sean?
Yeah.
Or actually, wait a minute. That's me that's angry. Sean, you're 13.
Yeah.
You want to know if you can change the taste of semen?
Uh-huh, like by what you eat.
No. But thank you for waiting 82 minutes to ask that question.
Oh, really? Because I heard, like, if you eat pineapples, it makes it taste
good. No, you can't change it.
I actually heard that if you eat fruit, like something like that.
Yeah.
What is that about?
Or if you eat, like, peppers, it makes it taste
It's about wrong. Guys with too much time on their hands.
Way too much.
That funny? I actually heard that.
Listen, hey, Sean.
You're hanging out with guys with too much time on their hands.
I don't know.
The only real way to change
a
the taste.
A woman told me that.
Ooh.
I'd like to meet her. Is that Pamela? Sean?
Yeah.
You can't really change the taste of it coming out of you, but you can change the taste of it, you know, once it's out of you. You know what I mean? Not when it's in you, but when it comes out of you. Like if you mix it with enough Bosco syrup or something, I'm sure you could cut it, right, Drew?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Sean.
Tasty.
All right, thanks.
That's a good plan. As I've said a few times though with this, it doesn't really matter what you eat. Your crap still smells. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I could eat just a tub of Cool Whip and strawberries, and my dookie would be just as bad as it was the day before, right?
Stuff that's coming out is coming out the way it's coming out.
There you go. And you can tweak it a little bit,
no,
but
you
for
can
the
make
most
it
part,
worse.
You can make it worse. You just can't make it better. There you go. So, ladies, just get used to it. What the hell happened to... But let me explain this, too. And it's been a little while since we've gotten into this, Drew.
I want to
bring it up in front of Molly in case this thing blossoms in any kind of relationship. I can, you know, give her the speech now. As far as the semen goes, it's not important that you ingest it by any stretch of the imagination. You know, men constantly talk about swallowing this and swallowing that. Not necessary, at least for me. All you got to do is make it from my penis to the bathroom without spilling any, and I'm fine. And I think most guys would be, too, if you're just talking about oral sex. Not you, per se, Molly, because you're a big star. You'd probably have your assistant do it. But what I'm saying is we're not so interested in the swallowing aspect of it as we're interested in the uninterrupted aspect of it. You know what I mean?
Follow through.
Yeah, it's like, I put it this way. I go to the refrigerator, I take a swig of milk, it went bad. I don't spit it all over the frozen food. I go to the sink and then I just spit it out in the sink, right?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Drew, don't act disgusted. This is an important message.
No, I'm just trying to figure out what the important message is, and it's not about how to transport disgusting material in your mouth.
No, it is. It is.
It's about how to know what males are looking for.
Well, what I'm saying is men, I think, they do themselves a great disservice by talking about swallowing all the time.
Yeah.
Women don't want to do this, and I wouldn't do it either.
So
You don't
want to see a woman spit it out in front of you?
I'm saying, here's what I'm saying. No, you could spit it out in front of me. I mean, I would make an exception. No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Drew, you keep a spittoon by the side of your bed for that. Is that right? Or is it a ficus plant?
What are you saying?
Here's what I'm
saying.
Here's what I'm
Molly's
saying.
Molly's actually getting pissed
right?
out of the
She's getting
curious,
angry now.
I
know, because she's a 1/18th Chippewa, and that's what gives her tenacity or something. But no, here's what I'm saying. And I'm sorry, Drew, I had to bring this up, but I'll see if I can't straighten it out and backpedal a little here. When it comes to oral sex, men are always talking about swallowing. Swallowing is a misnomer. What we need is...
Not stopping
until we're done kind of thing. But you do not have to ingest it. You can then go spit it in the toilet or spit it back on the guy or go spit it in the sink or wherever the hell you want to do with it. But you certainly do not have to swallow it. And although that sounds like six of one, half dozen of the other, I think it's a pretty big deal. Like most women, I'd put anything in my mouth, but I wouldn't swallow it.
Remember when you were a kid and you'd play on the sprinklers? And
yeah.
Every once in a while you'd take like a cup or a pitcher or something, turn it upside down on top of the sprinkler.
Right.
And the way stuff would kind of...
Right.
Is that okay?
You mean... Yeah. Yeah. I guess that's all right. Right. Whatever it is, though, but here's the point. Just don't stop whatever it is you were doing that got us to that point in the first place. If you can hold out for another 2 or 3 seconds, it'll all be over. That's what I'm saying. But you certainly do not have to swallow. All right? All right. Now we know.
So glad you clarified.
Wow. Is that upsetting to you, Molly?
No, not at all. I'm just thinking, who are you probably talking about? I don't know. I mean, women,
given that nobody would actually do this with Adam, who are you talking about?
No, I'm not talking about me personally. I have people take care of this.
But we
have interns over at the Man Show.
Do you know what? Women actually talk about this.
I know.
Women talk about this, and the women I know probably wouldn't stop. I don't understand.
They wouldn't stop.
No,
okay. Uh-huh. Oh, so
I'm just saying. I'm wondering who you're talking about.
I'm preaching.
I'm preaching
to the choir.
Women.
God bless you. I hear you.
Women know. Some women just know.
Right. I think a lot of women think the choice is swallow or get the hell out of them.
Yeah.
But they don't realize there's
an
alternative.
I really think it comes down to knowing who you're with. If it's just sex, you might not know. But if you can tell what's making someone happy or what isn't making someone happy.
Right.
And you'll just know.
Okay.
You know.
All right. I'm glad we've set those ground rules for the relationship. Julie?
Yeah. Hi.
You're 19.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
My boobs hurt.
They're killing me. I just want to slide that in there. Yeah? Why?
I don't know. They're just kind of sore. I have a puppy, and I mean, they're kind of big.
Wait a minute.
Small, but he'll, touch him with his paw, and I'm like, ow.
Oh, just right now, or this is always the case?
Well, they were always a little sore, but it's been worse lately.
Are they big?
Pretty big. I guess between a C and a D cup.
Lately is how long?
A few months, I guess.
How old are you?
19.
You pregnant?
No.
True. Why does a woman's breast get sore?
Well, usually it is.
You think they're growing?
Well, that's what I was wondering.
I hope not.
Oh, really?
I don't want them any bigger.
But usually,
well, I do.
But usually it's cysts, inflammation, that sort of thing.
On both?
Yeah.
Simultaneously?
Yeah, women get, and it usually tends to occur around the time of your period.
Ew.
Does it happen around the time of your period?
No, they're kind of sore all the time.
Try cutting out caffeine and chocolates.
I drink a lot of coffee.
Yeah.
You do.
And is your weight up at all? How's your weight doing?
I don't know. I'm about 10 pounds overweight, I guess.
Mm.
5'2", 130.
Hold on. Let me do the radio math there. 5'2", 130. Put that through the radio equation. Carry the 7. 4'10 1/4, 152.
Ooh, you're fat.
Yeah. Yeah, to do the radio math there. All right, so I got a few extra pounds on her, breast of sores. Why don't you cut back on the caffeine and see where it goes from there, right?
Well, yeah, and check out the kind of bra she's using. Sometimes we get irritation from the wire. There's all kinds of little nuances that can occur, but most commonly you worry about the cyst, and that usually, though, is around the time of the period.
All right. Should I talk more about semen in the mouth, or do you want to go to another call?
I think another call.
Okay, maybe just one. Carrie?
Yeah.
You're 20?
Yeah, I'm 20.
You're on with Molly Culver from VIP.
Oh, woo!
I know, you ladies must love that show.
Thank you.
A lot of stuff blowing up, a lot of chicks running around.
To be perfectly honest, I get a lot of comments from lots of women, I think. More women than I do men, actually.
Really? And what's a comment? I hate your show. I wish you'd all
die.
No,
they say, like, you're fierce!
Uh-oh.
Because we kick butt.
It's the Powerpuff Girls.
Don't empower women.
Yes.
Yeah, it is.
Oh,
it's
no.
Girls kicking ass. This is the Powerpuff.
I know, but it's ridiculous. It's like, I'm going to put on these cutoffs and blow something up.
We'll get you on the show.
Oh, please. I have to talk to my agent. Go ahead. Carrie?
Yeah.
Yes? What's up?
Well, okay, whenever I sleep, my boyfriend, he molests me. I swear to God. He touches me. He doesn't remember it in the morning. He's like, at first I was like, oh, do you want to do it now? But no. He's like.
What is he doing?
Well, he'll just start kissing my neck and stuff and then just start, you know, rubbing and stuff. And then, like last night, he grabbed my hand and, you know, he put it on him and I'm like, He really doesn't remember it, he said.
Does he have other kinds of sleep disturbances?
Yeah, he talks in his sleep, too.
Yeah. Does he drink a lot or use pot or anything like that?
I'm sorry?
Does he do any substances?
No.
Doesn't drink or?
Well, yeah.
How often does he drink?
Not very often.
Not very often?
No. I wouldn't say last night we did, but it's not like, it's not, you know.
Do you have, do you have alcoholism in your family?
In my family?
Yeah.
No.
No?
No.
Okay.
Hey, Carrie. Listen, if I was a cop, I'd arrest you immediately.
Yeah, because you sound so ashamed of the fact that your boyfriend uses alcohol, and I just was sort of following that.
Definitely not.
And was he drinking last night when he did this?
Oh yeah.
So maybe this is a function of the alcohol.
Oh yeah. He doesn't. He's not much of a drinker though.
But it's not like that's not the coincidence. I don't think it's.
He's done it on nights where he wasn't drinking.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. All right. Does he work construction?
No.
What's he do?
He sells cars.
Uh-oh. Clip-on tie?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, you got to get rid of this guy.
No.
You really do. What kind of cars does he sell?
Toyotas.
No, that's it. I don't trust cars. Car salesmen are, you know, genetically flawed. They're horrible. People who sell anything are horrible, but especially cars.
Well, we didn't sell them before I met him.
All right, well, listen.
Does he take any medication?
No.
Is it a new relationship?
No, 8 months.
Why did you have to...
8 months. And why do you have to do a very suspicious sort of a hesitation in every one of your goddamn answers?
Does he have any medication? No.
Alcohol? Last night, but... just answer.
Does he take a medication?
No.
Good.
Not that I'm aware of.
All right, goofball.
Find out if it's on any medication.
I hope he rapes you with a mop panel while you're asleep tonight.
His sleep is disturbed, and the most common reason would be substance or medication.
Yeah, guys like that, though, you know.
Yeah.
And she feels wanted. I mean, it's all right. Guys will do that, especially when the relationship's new. If they last for a few years, don't worry. He's going to put a piece of duct tape down the middle of the bed. I'll go, this is my side, that's your side. It'll be like a Lucy sketch. He'll saw it in half. But, you know, at the beginning, you're doing a lot of, you know, doing a lot of squeezing, a lot of, you know, that's what I do, Drew. I'm a big spooner, Molly. That's my thing. I get right on in there.
Are you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got enough love to go around. I'll tell you that right now. I get the arms wrapped around there. I cuddle up nice and tight.
The sensitive guy.
Yep.
I can see it.
Yep. Probably wouldn't
just,
break wind for the first couple
say,
of
just
nights.
Just to keep people away from his rear. So you want her to see. You can't anybody see your forest.
Oh, please, Drew. Why do you have to get in right in the middle? We're making some, you know, a beautiful concerto here, and you come in with your guitar like El Capone. Hit me over the head with it, Ashley. It's hard to hear you over the sound of my own ass.
First of all,
what's going on with this show?
Adam?
Yes?
You're a hottie.
That's right, I am.
And many of my friends think so.
And they're smart to think so, too, and it's high time. I'm recognized for the sex symbol that I think I am.
Ashley.
Okay, my problem. It would be my brother.
Uh-oh.
He is highly sexually active.
How old is he?
17.
Nine. Mm. 17, yeah.
All the time. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. And it's usually when it's, like, me and him will be home alone, and he'll invite his girlfriend over, and they'll go in his room, and they're so loud. It's like they're inconsiderate and everything.
Do they, have you discussed this with them? Have you acknowledged this or put them on notice about this?
I've brought it to their attention many times that it bothers me, and they don't seem to care.
Well, what about your I know your dad's not around, but what about your mom?
She doesn't like it at all.
She doesn't.
They threatened that if he did it again, that they were going to take off his door so that he couldn't, you know, do that.
Yeah.
But he's done it many times since.
When did your dad split?
Huh?
When did your dad split?
Oh, he's still here.
He is?
Yeah.
Well, what's he doing?
My dad kind of thinks it's cool or something.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, boy.
It's like, yeah, you go. You got this thing on. Oh, God, it's terrible.
No way. I love these.
That's a great message to his daughter, too.
Arrested adolescent retarded dads.
Yeah.
What's your dad do?
He's a paleontologist.
Oh, I knew it. I knew it.
Is he on a TV show where there's a bunch of couples? And
no.
No.
He digs up bones. Don't take that the wrong way.
Yeah. And
did anybody get my reference?
Yeah, and is he, no. Hold on a second, is he out on digs or something?
Mm-hmm.
He is.
All the time.
So he's not around.
Mm.
Does he wear like hirachis and a rope belt?
No.
No, is he, hold on a second, Drew, now you're confusing me. So your dad, where does he go? He goes abroad for these things?
No, just locally, nearby.
He goes down the beach, he digs up a sand dollar, and then he comes home again?
Do you live in Montana or Utah or something?
No, there are sites all over the place. They can be like a block from your house, and you wouldn't even know it unless you knew the right people.
Wow.
Is he gone for a long time at a time?
No. Well,
is he home every night?
Yeah.
He is. Yeah. All right. And your mom can't enlist him to sort of lay the law down?
Well, she's told him to.
He thinks it's cool.
He's
All right.
He was he knows what it's like to be a teenage guy.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, I know.
So
what, your room is next to his?
It's across the hall.
Across the hall, and you hear everything.
Yeah.
You got hollow core doors? You don't have solid doors?
No, and the only
hollow core doors?
I'd try to drain them out.
Solid core,
Drown them out with the stereo, but the only stereo we have is in his room, so.
Yeah, okay, right. Listen to me. Ashley, here's what you need.
Yeah.
You need a noisemaker. I got one of these things. It's got the sound of the ocean. I swear to God, go down and get one of these things. You put it by the side of your bed. You turn on it. It sounds like waves coming in. I think I'm drowning
and
every night.
Parents need to create consequences, even if they walk in there with a fire extinguisher. I don't care what. Whatever it is they need to do, they need to create consequences.
All right. We're going to take a little break. I'm going to talk to Molly about the hollow core doors, and we'll be back after this.
Oh, baby. Yo, Loveline will be right back, homie.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz. This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Guest tonight is Molly Culver. You know her from VIP, Fox, Weekends. Starting to win Molly over with my discussions about home improvement with her. Any other questions?
No, that was great. Thank you.
You sure?
Fascinating.
Yeah. I got all the answers, you know. Quite handy to have around the house. Lindsay?
Yeah.
And I'm looking to be one of those house husbands. I'm looking to sort of stay home and work on the place while my old lady goes out and, brings home the bacon. I don't know if that's attractive to you.
He'll hold up his end of the bargain. I mean, your house will be a shrine.
So wait, let me get this. Mm-hmm. You're sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
You spoon.
I spoon.
You have a hairy ass.
You want to be a house husband.
Yeah.
In loungewear.
That's right. I like to dress comfortably.
Right.
But I'm no slacker.
Am I missing something?
Yes,
what else?
There is one thing.
I'm sorry.
I'm no yes. slacker. I'll build custom furniture. I'll do remodels.
You won't use it, right? What about the room that you created your house?
No, he will. But he'll use it with you too. But
yes,
his boyfriend Jimmy.
Ah,
my lover.
His lover. His life partner. His life partner.
My life partner Jimmy. Yes,
must make regular visits.
Yes. He does not have to be with you sexually at first.
Now, do you think this is...
It's important that you love him like I do. Thank you.
An asset.
That's right. Lindsay? No, could really... There's so many sides of me. I'm like a Rubik's Cube. Is it, right, Drew?
Yeah.
Yep. I'm constantly surprised. I should have a cologne named after me called Jack Off and Nap-a-Lot Guy. We'd work out the name, but I'm afraid we get the name... But I can see the commercial already. Jeez. Lindsay?
Yeah.
You're 20.
Man. Yes, I am.
What's up?
I was recently diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder, and I don't like counseling, and I was wondering if there's other ways to deal with it.
Why don't you like counseling?
Booze.
Because
Adam had suggested that earlier tonight.
It didn't work for me before.
Well, what happened to you?
When I was 17, I was gang raped.
Oh, boy.
And right after my grandma died, and then I tried to kill myself twice.
What happened before you were 17 is the big question.
Nothing.
No, come on.
Came on.
What led to you being these guys sensing they could victimize you?
Don't couch it that way. I'm just curious. What happened before the gang rape?
Nothing.
Nothing?
No.
Really?
If something happened, I don't remember it, but as far as I know, nothing.
Everything, I don't mean rape necessarily, but nobody hit you, anything like that?
Oh, well, my parents were divorced when I was younger, and my dad hit my mom, and I get migraines, so I take Vicodin. And then when I lived with him for a while, he took my Vicodin for himself, and he, lied to me about it.
So he's a drug addict.
Yeah, he is.
Here, and what happened with the gang rape? What were the circumstances?
I invited a guy over, and he brought more than just himself over. He brought three other friends, and they kind of...
Over to your house?
Yeah.
That you're living out with your mom?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Nobody was home.
Were you loaded?
No.
And where'd you meet this guy, and what made him think that was okay, and where'd you find him?
I met him when I was working.
Uh-huh.
And...
What do you do?
I'm a cashier.
Oh, okay. What's, what were so, All right, well, anyway, hey, Lindsay?
Yeah.
We're just poking around, because we've really, and it's sad, and I don't want to diminish... your experience in any way, because it's a real one and it's a horrible one, but we've never spoken to anyone who was gang raped who wasn't sort of busted by their parents or screwed over something earlier on in the first place. It never happens like the movies. It's something leads you to it. Doesn't make it right. Doesn't mean it should have happened.
It puts you at risk.
But you are put at risk through wherever the environment that you grew up. But so now you have post-traumatic stress disorder, and
PTSD is also more likely in people who come to the trauma with baggage.
Right.
Well, I know why it happened.
Why?
I think because ever since I was young, mostly because of my dad. Like, I trusted my dad, and then he betrayed me.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I get in a relationship, it's kind of like I pick a guy that I know
that's going to betray.
Yeah,
of course.
Right.
Like, why do you think
I do it on a purpose? I mean, I don't even try to do it.
Why do you think you do that? Why do you think you do that?
I don't know.
Just if you had to guess.
Probably. I don't know.
All right, Drew. Well, come on.
I'm just curious how she would perceive it.
I know, but our callers can't articulate themselves emotionally that way at all. Hey, Lindsay?
Yeah?
Listen, I know you don't like therapy, but that's tough. You gotta go.
Put me on Xanax.
Yeah, that's the treatment for PTSD. However, you're an addict.
I am?
Yeah, I suspect. I mean, you've been on Vicodin for a long time, and your dad's
an
addict.
Ever since I was nine, I was.
Yeah, so, yeah. So
do you take it all the time, or just for your migraines?
I take it for my migraines.
Which is all the time.
Well, no, I haven't really. I've had three migraines in the last year.
So you've only taken Vicodin three times?
In the last year.
I take it back then. You may not be an addict.
But before that, after I realized that my dad took those pills from me,
yeah.
I think I started taking them more because my friends at school, like, talked about them, and I hung out with people who smoked marijuana, and I started taking them for fun. And then I realized that I didn't want to be like him, and I just stopped.
Okay.
And I would listen to you guys talking about Vicodin and how it was,
oh, really?
Like, really dependent. And
yeah,
it didn't do anything for me.
It started making me sick.
Okay, well, listen, Lindsay, you got to get into counseling. Sorry. Listen, I go to the shrink. Well, I wasn't even gang raped. Well,
there are behavioral therapies for PTSD. I mean,
I've been through so many counselors, and I just... it doesn't work for me.
Yes, it does.
You have to stay with them for
a few
years.
You got to let it work.
Yeah.
You're not letting it work.
Well, you're moving around. Right. It's too scary to be vulnerable. I think there's something very heavy that has yet to come out here. And but be that as it may, there are behavioral managements for this kind of thing. There are behavioral interventions that are quite effective for dealing with PTSD.
Talk about horrible first aid etiquette. You know what I mean? Yeah. Gang rape, first aid, bringing. But again, what is it magically that makes a guy talk to a girl who's working as a cashier, who invites a guy over for, like, a first date? What is it that makes the guy think, I'll bring Russ, Stu, and Bob with me, and we'll all nail this chick?
Yeah.
I mean, why does he know
that
it's
okay?
Based on something?
It's a little bit.
I mean, it's based on her victimization from the past. It has to be.
And there's an interesting feedback in this, too, which is she lets him in the door.
Right.
Guy's a creepy guy. She goes after him.
So it's a pattern. It's a pattern in a woman who's actually, that there is something that men pick up on. They come in and...
Yeah, victim.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Victimizers see victims. It's unbelievable.
Right. Well, you got to look at it this way, too, in a sad sort of Darwinistic sort of way. Guys, you know, animals hunt and animals look for the weak prey that straggle behind so they can pounce on. They're not really interested in a good
chase,
run.
Yeah.
They're not, I mean, that's how the animal kingdom works. I mean, cheetahs. Yeah, they could outrun a gazelle, but why burn up a bunch of calories? There's the lame one who's straggling behind. I'll jump on that one. And there's a lot of guys out there that aren't that far from animals. And they go, yeah, I could take this chick out to a whole bunch of dates, and maybe I get a hand job in a car in a month. Or there's this screwed-up chick who her dad screwed with her. She's working behind the counter. I'm just going to nail her, just rape her. It's sad,
natural,
but it's
selection.
It's true.
Yeah, it's wild. Mm.
Stephanie?
Yes?
You're 18.
I am.
What's up?
I was just wondering what me and my boyfriend could do. We've been going out for over a year. We've been having sex for about a year. He was a virgin before I met him, and he lasts no more than 20 seconds.
Oh, I double that. Triple.
We have tried everything.
What has he tried?
We have tried jacking off. We have bought videos to enhance the... you know, longevity of them.
Longevity?
Yes. We have...
And the latitivity? If you're going to be a mariner, you have to know both.
We have tried everything. The only thing that we have found that is...
In the prime meridian? All right. So you didn't get anything out of his longevity with these videos?
Nothing.
And what videos were these? Like blood on the asphalt or something? what kind of video do you...
It's hey, Vern goes to St. Louis or something, right?
Oh, yeah. Vern goes to hell.
It was an educational video. And so, because we tried everything. The only thing that we found that...
Is that one of those 50s movies in black and white?
Right.
No.
What kind of educational video?
I don't know. My boyfriend rented it.
Oh, he did?
Yes.
Oh, listen, that was Taboo 5. He just whacked off all night, tried to clean himself out.
No, this is seriously a problem.
I know, but I want to know what kind of educational video he rented to add to his sex life. I mean, add to the time spent with you sexually. You don't know what it was called?
I don't remember what
it was. Would you guys ever try doing it a second time?
Oh, all the time.
And what happens?
The same exact thing.
About 30 seconds?
At the most.
How about a third
I want to meet him. At the most?
At the most.
At the most? 30 seconds?
The only thing that we have found that has made him last long is I had my wisdom teeth pulled and I had Percocet.
Oh, boy.
And he took that and that made him last.
You got him like a minute and 20?
This was like 25 and that was a record.
25 minutes.
What?
25 minutes, right?
Yes, 25 minutes.
So, all right, let me just make sure I got something straight here. He has sex with you.
Yes.
He orgasms in 20 seconds.
Yes.
Not even a minute, just 20 seconds.
20 seconds.
Okay. Then, how long does he wait before you have sex again?
We could do it right afterwards.
Immediately after?
Yep.
Same erection?
No.
Different jizz.
Yeah.
That's, no, different erection? Whose erection?
No.
His, because I'm missing one. I swear to Christ, if I find out which one he took it, you'll have hell to pay. I opened my erection drawer this morning, there was one missing. I may have gotten drunk and left it somewhere last night, but I don't think so. I keep them all numbered.
No, it wouldn't matter if it was the same or if it was different.
All right, but the point is moments later, you have sex again, and he has another orgasm in 20 seconds.
Yes.
I cannot believe that. To be young again.
Swear to God.
Young again.
Can they do it?
I'd have an aneurysm.
And three and four times? Yeah, can they do it again?
Keep going until he cannot do this?
I think he needs a little maintenance. Corolla maintenance.
What's that mean?
I come over and blow him.
He cleans the plumbing out very regularly.
I come over and give him a hand job. Is that what you're talking
about? Really?
No, he does it himself.
No, he jacked off. I've jacked him off. We've done everything.
Okay, listen. He's got to kill himself. I don't know what else to say. Molly, I do not have this problem. I want to be up front with you right now. I'm good all night. All night, right, Drew?
You've said on this show that you have the ninja command.
I do. I will hook me up to a lie detector right now.
Yeah.
You have
the
one
ninja
of those polygraphs?
Command.
I've never had an orgasm before I was ready to
have that orgasm.
I didn't want to have. Never. Never.
Doesn't that seem like...
I've had sex four times now. 35. No. Never have.
Before you wanted to? Well,
never before.
Who's to say you don't want to, like, you know, all the time that you just have
I it. Usually want to in the first 25, 30 seconds. Love
so
me.
There.
No. Never. Never once. Never in my life. I can have sex for 3 hours and then go, I'm going to have an orgasm now and within a minute and a half. Do it. But I can do it 3 hours. It's just the way I'm cut out.
Can you say, I want to do it in 10 minutes instead?
I can say.
Is this the ninja element?
I can say I want to have an orgasm in
12 minutes.
4 minutes, yeah. 5 minutes. I could say I want one in 15 or 10 minutes, or I could say an hour and a half.
Do you consult with your partner to see
what? Or I could just go for an hour, and the partner could go, hey, Murder, She Wrote, starting in 5 minutes. Oh, done.
Do you consult with the partner, or is it just purely up to your whim?
Right.
I like to suss it out a little bit, see how they're doing, you know.
Let me translate. New partner wants to impress? 2 hours.
That's right.
The usual thing? 3 minutes.
Once a couple weeks into it.
That's over.
It's all over. It's true. God, is it true? Yeah. It is so true. It's so misleading. They called Ralph Nader on my penis. Nothing truer. And go, Molly, if you ever made the mistake of sleeping with me first time, 2 hours,
whatever you wanted,
whenever you wanted, as long as you wanted, world's greatest penis. But then, if we really settled into something serious,
6 months later,
But it's still every once in a while, like for your birthday,
for
holidays or something. Yeah,
holidays, my birthday.
You for the porn bunker keys, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's doomed. Listen. I'm no good for you, honey. I'm telling you right now. Don't get sweet on
We've
me.
We've had a whole relationship.
That's right.
In like an hour and a half.
I got to cut you loose. I hope you understand. Don't take it wrong. All right? I'm looking out for you.
All right.
You're a good kid. All
Thank
right?
You.
I want to see you get hurt. All right. We'll be back.
Let's have some more fun.
Okay. Let's do it. Call LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191.
LoveLine will be right back.
Well, here's how it's sampled.
Oh, tired. I'll do the lightning round tomorrow. I haven't been home yet. I didn't get any sleep last night. My throat's killing me.
You too? That's where I got the sore throat from.
Yeah. You gotta stop making out after the show, seriously.
Well, you stop, the day you stop being so goddamn cute, it's the day you're gonna stop getting made out with after the show, all right? That's the deal. Maybe Molly will keep me occupied. You make a run for the car, but I still might get to you. I don't know. She's going to have to be an awful good kisser for me not to give you a good smooch goodbye. We're like family over here. All right, anyway. Molly Culver is our guest tonight from VIP. She was starting to heat up on me a little bit, I think, there around the 11 o'clock hour, but she's cooled down.
We just
down.
Broke up, I thought.
You ran a relationship.
Yeah. You know why? It's because I care for you too much.
You let me go. I appreciate that.
I could see you were getting too involved too fast. And I know how you ladies get, and I know your actresses can be, and I didn't want to ruin your confidence. You know what I'm saying? So I just want to nip this one in the bud. Hey, it was a good time.
It's for the best. I hear you.
And I'm glad you have that attitude. I hope we can be friends. I don't want any weirdness. I'm sure we're going to run into each other at parties and whatnot.
He's going to cut you off and never be seen again.
No, I want you in my life. I really do, because you're important.
Sensitive guys comes through.
I'll always have fond memories about us.
Line 4.
And line 4.
Jamie,
you're 13.
Yeah. Over Christmas break.
Hold on a second. I'd like us to go into counseling together. See if we can put this back together.
Or just to deal with
I think
the
there's something left here. Either to deal with the transition out of the relationship or to see if there's something left.
I'm for that. I like counseling.
All right. I was supposed to go this morning, but I had to film something, so I'll make us an appointment later on in the week, okay?
You're still wasting your therapist time.
Are you saying I can't make an appointment? Are we fighting?
No, we can go to your guy if you like. No problem. Jamie?
Yeah?
You're 13?
Yeah.
I think we should go to a third
what's
person
going on?
That doesn't know either one of us.
That's a good idea.
Okay.
Jamie, what's up?
Over Christmas break, I was at my cousin's house for my cousin's bar mitzvah. Because my cousins are, like, Orthodox Jews or whatever.
Yeah.
So my 15-year-old cousin started to get, freaky with me. And he wanted to, mess with me or whatever. Yeah. And so I was, going to the bathroom, and he, pushed me in the bathroom, and he started, fingering me. He made me touch him. And so I went to counseling, and I asked her, if I was molested, and she said, yeah, and I don't know if I should tell my mom.
Yes.
I should?
Yes.
Yeah.
Did your mom help you go to counseling?
Yeah, she went with me, but I didn't tell her. And
maybe do it with the therapist present.
Did this just happen one time?
Yeah, but then I saw him this past weekend, and he's like, yeah, I'll pay you $20 if you take off your shirt.
Okay, this is somebody you're going to have to deal with for a long time, and your parents need to help you manage.
He's going to make a hell of an agent or manager one day, this young Jewish lad. Is he out in California?
Uh-huh.
No, perfect. All right. Yeah. And he had his bar mitzvah a few years back?
Yeah, 2 years ago.
Well, he's a man now.
Mm-hmm.
He's 15, though. Yes, tell your mom and tell the therapist.
I think tell your mom with your therapist present. That'd be a great way to do it.
Yeah, and this guy... You know, not only for your own good, but for his own good.
He was molested when he was a little
no
kid.
No kidding.
There you go. Also,
I think he's been accused of raping a girl.
Yeah.
No surprise.
No surprise. And listen, everybody, it really is for their good. I mean, if you got a 13, 14, 15-year-old kid who's starting to spin out of control... because of how he was victimized when he was younger, could easily have a few drinks and rape somebody in the park and then be in prison for 15 years, you're doing that guy a favor you intervene now at 15. Yeah, sure, it's uncomfortable. Sure, it's embarrassing. But if you could get him into some kind of counseling at this point and bring some consequences to bear on him, you are doing him a favor. Corey. One goddamn letter off, you guys. Once you guys go out in the parking lot and yuck it up. I'm going to help the people.
Corey.
I'm sorry I lashed out at my mouth. We'll talk about that in therapy.
Corey.
I really mean it. I'd like us to go into therapy together.
Corey.
Hello?
Can we do that?
15. What's going on?
We may not have issues yet, but I'm saying let's nip them in the bud.
Done. Corey, we got 30 seconds.
Hey, I just want to say I'm a huge fan. I love you guys.
Thank you.
Listen every night. Actually, I don't really have a question. I just wanted to say keep up the good work and making fun of the fans mercifully. I love it.
Thank you. All right. All right, that's good enough. And so it's a fine way to go into break.
Yeah.
What do you think of that strategy of Molly and I going into therapy before we have an argument or even a first date?
Or even a relationship. Yeah, of course. It's like premarital counseling.
Lay some ground rules down.
What do we call this? Pre
ejaculate.
Pre-relationship.
Pre-relationship.
Think it's been done?
Yeah. I don't think it's been done.
No.
I think it'd be a very interesting experience. And we could sit like on the sofa and sort of hold hands and talk about what we both want and stuff. But meanwhile, we've never been out on a date yet. Actually, our first date would be to the therapist's office.
That would be a first.
All right. That's good. And what you know, a lot of women want to go out for lunch because it's a little...
No.
Let's go to the therapist's office. Let's just get right into it. Let's not pussyfoot around. We know there's something. We know this is heading a certain direction, right? Okay. And then we're going ring shopping. All right, not a ring.
Just got done whacking off to my mom.
Oh.
Go to break before it gets too late.
Please. Hey, I'm going to go talk to that Anderson.
What's up?
Loveline. Loveline will be right back.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
Let's go. Well, that is it. Another show put to bed. And I wish this one could have gone on another hour. I really do.
You wish this one would never end.
It never end. That's what I meant. That's how in love with Molly Culver I am. And Drew, you know that's not just talk, right?
He talks about you all the time.
Don't scare Drew.
He's not intending to stalk, but it might cross over something.
If I wasn't so goddamn lazy, I'd be stalking.
Yeah. Well, we're going to therapy.
That's right.
We're going into counseling, therapy.
We'll do both.
You call her my girl. What do you call her? My Molly?
I call her mommy.
For short.
That's right. VIP, everybody, this weekend. You watch Mommy and Company over there. making me proud. All right, so until next time, this is Adam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying, Mommy Hollow. Oh,
well, now.
This has been Loveline. The stuff expressed on Loveline is not necessarily the stuff of the staff, management, sponsors, or anyone else, including Westwood One Entertainment. Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins Ingold. Now, please enjoy these birds.